Hi everybody, Penny Johnson here. In today's presentation, we're going to talk about what it takes to be a virtual assistant, and we're going to review the top 10 things you should be thinking about if you are wondering if a virtual assistant career is right for you. Let's go ahead and begin. First, I'm going to tell you a little bit about me. So when I graduated high school, I felt like I wanted to be an administrative professional. I didn't go to college, I just went out and got a job. So I got my first job at a local furniture store. My job title was office aide, and I was one of those people who sat in the back of the store and took care of the record keeping, took care of the paperwork, did all the administrative stuff to make the store run. I really loved that career, and I continued up the career ladder. Soon I was working as an administrative assistant to 6 managers, and after a time I moved up to the ladder again as an executive assistant to a vice president. All along the way, I also knew that I loved teaching. So at night, I took college classes and I kept going until I obtained my graduate degrees. And luckily enough, I came across the position that I'm in now, teaching in the administrative professional program at Madison College in Madison, Wisconsin. So let me tell you a little bit about our program so you can see the context of my teaching background. Madison College was the first college recognized by IAAP for our administrative professional program, and we're super proud of that. We're 100% online. We've been 100% online since 2001, and since that time, we've been working with IAAP members to help them obtain a college degree, because in today's work world, having those credentials really matters. It matters for job retention and job promotion and all that kind of thing. So I have students who are brand new to the career field. They want to be who you are. And then I have other students who already are administrative professionals. They are IAAP members. They just need a credential. And so they can come in with credits already earned, right, for the work experience, if they hold their cap, all sorts of things. So it's really just a great field to be teaching in. All right, let's go ahead. Enough about me. Let's go ahead and get started. As I mentioned, we're going to talk about the top 10 reasons that you should become a virtual assistant. And this is kind of funny. I just framed it this way so that we would have a way of thinking about the important things to consider when you think you might want to become a virtual assistant. So that's how I framed our discussion today. Let's get started with reason number one. So most people really like the idea of becoming their own boss, right? It seems ideal. I don't have to listen to somebody else telling me what to do. I get to decide what I want to do. And that is really appealing. It's a great feature of being a virtual assistant. The flip side of that coin is that you take on all the responsibilities of a boss. You have to network and get clients. You have to structure contracts. You have to take care of all of the responsibilities with completing those contracts and dealing with negotiations. So you have to be ready to take on the sort of stress and weight that bosses take on. You'll be a business owner, so you have to be ready to step up to those responsibilities. That has to be appealing to you and something that you're willing to do if you want to be a virtual assistant. Don't let it stop you, don't let it scare you, but just be ready to don't be naive about the responsibilities that it takes to run a business successfully over time. It really is a rewarding thing. Okay, number two, you need to consider the goals that you want for your business. And right now at this time, I want to make sure that everybody has a piece of paper and a pencil or a tablet or a phone where you can take notes while we go through these 10 items. Because right now I need you to start taking notes. I want you to jot down what is the goal for your VA business. And here's how I want you to think about it. Is it your goal that your VA business will take the place of your full-time job? If that's the case, I need you to think about the amount of work it's going to take to get a new business up and off the ground and generating the kind of income you are currently used to. for most of us, that means doing a lot of networking, doing a lot of marketing, being ready to do a lot of work to get that business up and off the ground. Now, on the full spectrum, that's like one end of the spectrum. That's the big VA business. And I know women who have done it, and they're fantastic. On the other end of the spectrum is perhaps someone like me. I wanted to start my own VA business so that I could talk intelligently to my students about what it meant to be a virtual assistant. So about 7 years ago, I launched my VA business, but I really do it just as a side hustle. So I take one, maybe two clients a year. That means I don't do a ton of networking. I do a little bit of networking. I throw a line in the water to see if a fish comes along. But I don't have to devote a ton of time to it. So you have the sort of big picture VA, and then you have the little picture VA. And that might be something that you want to try out at first, is just doing it as a gig or a side hustle, getting your toes wet in the water. And then I also hear oftentimes from administrative professionals who want to become a VA in their retirement life. And that's a great sort of middle ground. It's not the occasional small project once or twice a year, and it's not the full-blown business, but it's somewhere in the middle where you need clients who are maybe consistent over time that will work with a little flexibility, a little more flexibility because you're in your retirement years, right? So it's kind of that middle of the road. You need to determine what is the goal for your VA business. And I need you to do that now because it's going to determine the kinds of things you do to establish your business. All right, so I hope you have that note ready. Let's move on. Number three, we have all heard of this VA trend for years, and we know that it's growing, that there's a growing popularity. Let me read some statistics to you. So according to the Small Business Administration, there are approximately 23 million small firms in the U.S. Roughly 75% of those firms have no employees other than the owner. And that's us, right? That's us. We're going to be the virtual assistant who owns our own VA business, and we're the employee. That's it. We're on our own. So that's a huge number. 23 million small firms like this exist in the U.S. So there really is such a growing trend. What that means is we're not in alone. We can learn from others. If you know someone who owns their own small business, you can learn from them. What do they need to know about having a lawyer on hand or having a tax accountant on hand, right? That person doesn't have to be a VA. There's something in common about just being a small business owner, and we see them all over the place. Okay, what else does this mean for us specifically as virtual assistants? It means that there are people out there running their own businesses and taking care of their own offices who are maybe in need of a virtual assistant. I want to give you two examples. I have a nephew who works as a plumber, and that's it. It's him. He has his own plumbing business, and he does the plumbing work, and then he has to sit in the office and do all of his own administrative support work as well. So that's one example. Another example I have is one of my brother-in-law's. He owns his own sign company. So when you go to a business and you see the signs hanging up either outside, or if you've ever been to like a high school and you've seen the banners hanging about who won state championship, that's the kind of work my brother-in-law does. He makes those signs and banners. And again, he has no other employees. He's it. And he constantly grumbles about having to do his office work. To be frank, he hates it, right? He hates having to sit in the office, and he's not very good at it, so it takes him a long time to do it. That's where we come in. We're good at this sort of stuff, and we like it, right? I love getting in there with my brother-in-law because his office is a disaster. I mean, he's just really no good at it. And I love doing that kind of work, managing his client files, getting his records in order, making sure his task list is clear and updated on a regular basis, right? He hates that kind of work. I love that kind of work. He can hire me to offload that kind of work. on your notes that you're taking, right, you're writing down who you know. So who do you know who owns their own small business? And we'll keep adding to this list, but right now just think out loud to yourself. Well, not out loud, think to yourself, who do you know who owns their own small business that maybe could, you know, you could contact down the line in your networking for your VA business? I want to read you another statistic about another popular trend, outsourcing. 67% of adults would happily outsource a wide variety of tasks. 55% believe a virtual assistant would allow them to focus on more important tasks. 34% believe that outsourcing to a virtual assistant would allow them to improve their job performance. So another trend that we're seeing related to us as virtual assistants is this idea of working for large companies, not just small firms, but large companies as well, who are hiring virtual assistants, sometimes just as contract employees, to get small projects done. And I don't want to confuse our topic here. I am not saying that your job as a full-time administrative professional is going to be outsourced to a VA. That is just not true, and it's not beneficial to the company. Administrative professionals need to be full-time employees because of the benefits we bring when we understand the context and the complexity of the organization. That cannot be replicated by a contract employee nor a virtual assistant. Where a VA can be of benefit to a large organization is when there's projects, defined projects to be completed, or defined tasks that need to happen, all right? So I want you to start, well, we'll talk in a minute about thinking about the types of work that you could do for a large organization, but it is a trend that we see out there. Number four, no daily commute from home. This, which, you know, sounds kind of funny, it's a little bit trite, but what I really want to talk about here is what it means to work from home. What does that really mean for you and your virtual assistant business? I do have students who say to me, I want to be a VA so I can be at home with my kids. And that's great, but this is your business. These are your clients who you've worked hard to attract, and you're going to work even harder to keep. So don't make it a side note to your family life. And I don't mean to say you can't work from home. You totally can. My VA office is at my house. But here are two things you have to do. You have to physically set up your home office so that it's private and quiet and not interrupted. So that when you're at work in your home office, you are at work. And people aren't hollering at you from the next room because they can't find the potato chips or whatever, right? That you are going to work and you're off in your physical, your own space. It's not cluttered or distracted by anything else going on. Now, that can be in a bedroom that's not in use during the day, right? It doesn't mean it has to be an office room in your house. It can be another room. It's just that you're able to close a door and be physically at work within your home. Okay, and then, so that's the physical side of it. The second thing is that you have to set the expectations with your other family members. If you're going to be a VA while your small kids are at home, that's a great choice, but you have to then be able to define when you're at work, right? Because little kids don't, you know, we say, oh, I'll get work done while they're napping. Well, what if the little one won't fall asleep or wakes up early? So be definite about the hours that you can work. Either it's after they go to bed at night or before they wake up in the morning. And then be very clear about those expectations. Now, with little kids, it's actually a little bit easier because you can tell them to go to bed at night and they get used to a schedule. But with older kids or with other family members or other people living in your house, whether it's a partner or your parents or whoever, then it's about that relationship that you have with your other household members. That you're going to be very clear about when you're in your room, you are at work, and you're not available, right? Unless a crisis happens, but that they just understand that expectation. And I have to tell you about my husband. He is the best husband on the planet, but he just can't help himself. I'll go off to my VA room and I'll say, okay, honey, I'm going to work, right? And I've been doing this for 7 years, and I'll go off into my room, and sometimes I won't physically close the door because he's an adult and I've told him I'm off to work, but he just can't help himself, and he'll duck his head in the door and he'll say, oh, I forgot to tell you about what happened at, you know, so whatever happened today. And I have to just gently remind him, oh, honey, I'm really sorry. I'd love to hear the story, but I'm at work right now. I'll be done in a couple hours and I'll pop back in and check with you. All right, so setting those expectations physically and with your other household members. So related to the no commuting, right, you get to work from home, you also get to take your work on the road. You're not stuck in your house. You can work at a local library or a coffee shop. Or nowadays, we have all of the WeWork kinds of rental offices. I know a VA who just can't work at home. She needs the mental change away from her house to an office area where she works. So she rents an office space. She told me the reason is because when she was working at home, she just couldn't let go of all the other responsibilities. She knew the laundry had to get done. She was worried that the dog had to be let out and all of that. She just couldn't let it go. She needed to, for her own mindset, go somewhere else to work. But that's really one of the beautiful things, is that you can work from anywhere. Now, I do want to mention very quickly that we're a virtual assistant. That means we're not physically near our client. However, our clients are humans, and they're a big component of the kind of work you'll do as a VA is in building and nurturing those relationships with your clients, kind of like we do as APs with our executives, right? We're the administrative partner to our executive as an AP. As a VA, we're the administrative partner to our client, and all of this kind of stuff that happens for that relationship, sometimes that means you want to meet them in person, either just to reassure them or just to, you know, get that pat on the back or just add that human side to that kind of relationship. And for that, again, it can be anywhere, right? We're portable. We can meet them at a local library. We could meet them at their office or at their local coffee shop or whatever. Okay, portability of work comes in many forms. So we need to talk about the global nature of a VA business. We don't have to have clients that are physically near us. I just got done talking about the human side of things, but there are going to be clients who are quite comfortable with never meeting you. We have Skype, we have Zoom, we have all kinds of video conferencing to give us that human touch. And we can constantly be on our phones with our clients. Well, not constantly, but we can develop that relationship in other ways, which means that we can have global clients available to us. Our market for clients can be anywhere because we're virtual. Now, this also means that we have global competition. And I need to stop and talk about this because I get asked this question all the time. People say to me, Penny, how can I compete when there are internet sites offering virtual assistant services for pennies to the dollar of what I can charge? I can't charge such low rates. I have to pay the light bills and I have to pay for my laptop, and right, I have to make a living. How can I compete in this global marketplace? Here's what I want you to think about for this one. I'm going to give you three reasons that you can compete and three reasons that you're actually going to win the competition. The first is that we understand the nature of work in our American culture. We can produce high quality output quickly and responsively to our clients' needs. America has a high-paced business culture that sometimes is not represented in other countries. We understand that culture. We can get work done quickly, efficiently, and still to a high quality level. So that's just number one. Number two, we understand the relationships that serve as the basis for our VA work. We're not just doing a job, we're meeting our clients' needs. And over again, I hear from people who have either contracted with international VAs or have done that type of contract work with international assistance. And again and again, I get told that it was not worth it. It was super cheap, and it was not even worth that because they were just doing a job, and they were doing it as quickly as possible and at low level, right? Because it's so inexpensive. They're doing the lowest level quality that they can. So we're not about just doing that job. We're about providing services and products that meet our clients' needs. All right, also I want to mention with this one, think about the implications of how we communicate with our clients, right? It's different when you're just doing a job. Number three, we provide our experience from having worked in the field. We know the nuances of administrative work, and we can be proactive about providing the best possible product. And I want to use an example of a mail merge here. So sometimes small firms will send out what you might consider cold call letters or postcards to a local area offering their services. So think of like a financial planner. You might get a letter in the mail that says, hey, this is your local financial planner, Penny Johnson. I'd love to meet with you and talk about your retirement plan, right? You might get something like that in the mail. Well, who have they hired to do that little mail merge project and send it out? An international VA might not understand the nuances of our postal code system and so can't recognize errors. We can. Or we could recognize when a street address doesn't line up right, because we know what that's going to look like. So we can provide that best possible product. In addition, just think about the nuances of sending out a cold call letter. We can provide advice to our client on something like, well, maybe instead of sending that letter to all of this zip code, you consider sending it to maybe this zip code and this zip code, because instead of a blanket marketing campaign to everybody, it's more efficient to do a targeted campaign to people who are more likely to use your service, right? We can provide all of that kind of thing, whereas someone who's located far away might just not even know all of those nuances, where we can. And typically what happens with global VAs is they have a very clear contract, and so the client establishes, they say what the product is, and that's exactly what gets done. And clients don't often, you know, they don't always know. They haven't thought through all of the details. Whereas because we're here, we can pick up the phone and talk to them about, oh, so I see you need a mail merge project. Can I talk to you a little bit about what your needs are? What are you trying to do with this? You know, it's not just a mail merge. What are you trying to do with this? And develop it a little bit more along those lines. Okay, having a global marketplace kind of ties into this one. You have the opportunity to choose what type of work you want to do. If you wish to expand an area of interest that was not possible in your AP career, you could do that as a VA. So I want to tell you the story about a student that I had who was a full-time administrative professional. She wanted to become a VA because she wanted to do social media for clients. She wanted to take care of their social media accounts. In her position as an AP, she never got to work on social media, but she always wanted to. So she took a few extra classes, learned the social media, learned how to handle accounts, hung out her shingle for her VA business, and sold her services. And now that's what she does for her VA business. She handles her clients' social media accounts, something she never did as an AP. Are you keeping notes? I need to have you go back to your notes again. And I want you to start writing down, is there anything like that that you'd like to do? Now, I'll admit that student was uncommon. What I see most often with administrative professionals who become virtual assistants is that they play on their strengths. So I want you to think about, what are you good at? Are you good at mail merge? Are you good at taking minutes? Are you good at, you know, just start to think about, what are you good at and how can you sell that to a client? Okay, so I get told all the time, and maybe you do too, I bet money on it, that you get told, you're really good at organizing. People tell me that all the time. Oh, Penny, you're so good at organizing. So I had to stop and think to myself, all right, how do I sell that as a VA? How do I say I'm really good at organizing? Like, what does that mean? And so I thought about, when did people tell me that? And I could see a trend that people most often told me that when I was providing administrative support to a project or a project team. And then I thought about, well, what are the things that I do for that project team? So that's how I sold it in my VA business, is, do you have a project that needs to get done? Let me help with that project management side of the house, right? Let me help with the to-do list and wrangling the resources and making sure, let me help you make sure that your project gets done on time, under budget, right? All of those project management skills and with a high quality output. That was just one of the things that I sold my virtual assistant business on. I'm also pretty darn good with Microsoft Word. So I use that as something that I sell for my virtual assistant business. I can wrangle up your Word documents, develop templates, macros, you know, whatever. I can handle your Microsoft Word files to make them the most efficient for your business, so that all you have to do is pull it up, input XYZ, and it's ready to go. And us as APs, you know, sometimes business owners, they'll have Word documents that are, they're just a little bit different from each other, and they get handles a little bit, right? We can provide that consistency across files. Or maybe it's Microsoft Excel, or maybe it's Outlook, or whatever. Figure out what you're good at. Okay, and while you're jotting down, so right now, jotting down what you're good at, I'm going to tell you one more story, and that's about a virtual assistant I know who started her business to provide administrative support to a board of directors. And she started this, she had one board of directors, and she started this as a side gig, and that's what she was gonna do. And now she's developed her business. She has 7 boards of directors. All of them are nonprofit agencies, and she provides the administrative support to that board, to those boards. And in fact, that's actually a lot of work. She has 3 employees in her VA business. So sometimes you want to be able to provide a service that you're good at and that you can sell, right? You have to not only be really good at that thing, but you also have to be able to sell it to a client. But now added to that, it has to be something that clients want to buy. So oftentimes when we start our VA businesses, we will do whatever a client needs done, right? We're fishing for all kinds of fish. But then over time, we start to see what is it that we're good at and what can we concentrate on and build up our reputation as providing that kind of service. So I want you to think about that too. You need to start somewhere, so sell your strengths, but you can always also develop your strengths over time. All right, here it is. Finally, let's talk about pay. Everybody wants to know, what the heck, how am I going to make money at this? So you get to decide what you get paid. My first piece of advice is to not undersell yourself. Know what you're worth. And here's a couple of things you can do to figure out what you're worth. What did you recently pay your car mechanic? Did you hire a painter, maybe, to paint a room in your house? What did that person get paid? How about an electrician? Remember my plumbing, my nephew who's a plumber? What does he get paid per hour? All right, so I want to tell you about an electrician I recently hired. I paid him $125 an hour. And why was I willing to pay that much? Because I cannot go in the walls and start monkeying with wires. I can't do it. So I'm going to pay him a lot of money to do that. That's not quite where we fit. Because again, I want you to think back to my nephew who's a plumber. He can do his office work, and he does do his office work. But he doesn't do it well, and he doesn't like it. So it's better off for him to pay me as a virtual assistant to take care of his office work. Now, I can't charge him $125 an hour. That's already what he's paying himself to sit in the office. but maybe I can charge him. So I live in Madison, Wisconsin, so take this with, you know, this is sort of my regional rate. He can pay me $60 an hour to sit in his office, and it's worth it. So when you figure out what your rate is going to be and you start to tell it to people, some people, I'm just going to be honest with you, some people are going to say, what the heck? I'm going to pay you, and I'll be honest with you, I do now charge $75 an hour. And they'll say to me, $75 an hour to shuffle papers? Are you crazy? I don't need to pay that. But think about it. They do. My nephew should be out in the field plumbing, earning $125 an hour. He should not be sitting in the office shuffling papers, right? I hate that, but you know, he shouldn't be doing his administrative work. He should be out earning the money, and then when he's paying me $60 an hour in the office, that frees up his time. It's more productive, it's more efficient, and it's more profitable for him to hire a virtual assistant to get the work done. And by the way, you're worth $75 an hour, because what it takes you in an hour will take that person all afternoon, right? We're worth it to be paid that amount. Okay, so you have to figure out what rate of pay is right for you, but do not start low. I started low and I regret it. And I hear this from other VAs as well. Think about how hard it is to ask for a raise. It's even harder to ask a client to pay more than what they have been paying. So start high. Not too high, right? You don't want to be laughed at, but start high. And if fish aren't biting, then you can come down a little, right? And think about it objectively. What is your client getting paid per hour? What's a reasonable amount of money? And then earlier I was talking to you about the global competition, and we can't work for those rates. But remember the difference, right? I can also hire cheaper non-certified electricians, right? But why don't I? Because I want it to be insured and bonded and all that sort of stuff. We are totally worth it. Okay, then one more thing about wages or how your business is going to earn money. You get to determine whether or not you are paid by the hour or by the project. So this summer, I had a project I was working on, and it was brought to me. And so I talked to the client about what their needs were, and we talked about what the project might look like. And I estimated that it would take me about 20 hours to complete the project in its entirety. And so I charged my rate per hour, and we filled out the contract and signed it. And that's how I did it. The project, when it was near completion, actually maybe it was even completed, then the client came back to me and wanted to change a few things. And I said, that's fine. I am happy to change and do more work, but that I'm going to need to add more hours on to this contract. And they said, fine. And so we added some hours on and I did that additional work. And that's the way it turns out. And that is not uncommon. You can talk to clients about what their needs are, what their desires are, what is the outcome they're trying to achieve, and do your best estimating as to how much time and money that is going to cost. But then clients oftentimes come back and say, well, you know, I didn't realize blah, blah, blah. Or now that this is done, I see that this other thing is impacted and I didn't know that that was going to be impacted. And that's okay. Remain objective. You're a business owner. And just describe how that additional or alternative work is not within the scope of the contract and you're happy to complete it and it'll take this many hours. Now that's different. I could have said to my client this summer, it'll take me approximately 20 hours. Well, not even. I won't even estimate the time. I'll just say, based on the amount of work that it's going to take to complete this contract, I'm going to charge this much money. And it's per contract, right? And then when they came back to me to say, well, we need additional work done, I would have said, that's fine. I need to add an addendum to the contract because that wasn't within the scope of the work that we originally agreed on. So you can either be paid by project or by time. And then, as always, this is a sticky one because you need to maintain your client relationships. So don't become a doormat to your client Don't just willy-nilly do extra work, yet you want to be pleasing to your client so that hopefully they bring more business in the future. It gets better. It gets easier over time to play that role. Remember, confidence and professionalism, and always be objective. It's nothing personal, either for you or the client. How about them working hours? When you're a virtual assistant, you're not working 9 to 5. And as an administrative professional, we're most often used to working in an office environment, or at the very least, even if I'm not in the office every day, I'm working, you know, 9 to 5 or 8 to 5 or whatever it is. I'm used to working those daytime business billable hours. Well, not business hours. And that's not how it works for a virtual assistant. Your time is going to be here and there. It's on a kind of like an ad-needed basis. You have to be able to respond to your clients when they reach out to you, whether that's at 7 in the morning or 9 at night. Now, that doesn't mean you are going to be working from 7 in the morning to 9 at night. Think about it from your client's perspective. If they email you at 7 in the morning and say, hey, just wondering how's it going on that project, you can respond within 30 minutes, right? And then if they contact you again at 9 at night and say, oh, you know what, I just thought of something else. Had you thought about this when you were working on the project? Again, you can respond, and your client thinks, well, I contacted her at 7, I contacted her at 9, but she had all that free time in between, right? So that's how you have to think about it. Whether or not that free time was filled with another job, family obligations, in truth, it's not free time, right? You're running around doing other things. But from your client's perspective, you're working sort of on an ad hoc basis. Now, again, this doesn't mean you're going to be a doormat to your client. You get to define the expectations. You can say to your clients, I will not be as available on weekends, right? I'll respond to your inquiries as soon as possible, or whatever. I mean, maybe you want to respond on the weekends because you're trying to maintain that client relationship, whatever the expectations is. I tell my clients right up front, I'll answer your communications within 24 hours. And if you don't hear from me, it means service was interrupted and please try again. Like, no matter what, I'm going to respond. Why? Because I only have one or two clients. I can respond within 24 hours. Actually, I respond typically within 4 hours. But I can do that because it's not my entire life. I'm not like wrangling all of these clients all of the time. Okay, number 10. Here we are at number 10. You're ready. If you have been telling yourself for the last 9 reasons that if you've been saying, I'm in, I like it, this is what's appealing to me, now you're ready. Now you're ready to launch your VA business and get your name out there. So how do you do it? How do you find clients? Do you remember earlier I was talking to you about outsourcing and how you should pay attention to the kind of work that's happening at your organization now? Well, make note of those projects that aren't getting done. Make note, when you think of a task that's being completed that maybe you can serve as a virtual assistant, you're going to make notes for yourself now. Who would you contact about that idea? How would you propose that, right? Because they're going to want a business proposal. They're not going to want you just to slide in their office and say, hey, I could be your virtual assistant. I could, right? You have to have a formal business proposal ready to go. And it's a business proposal that's convincing and that sells yourself, that makes them understand that you, hiring you as a VA is profitable to them. Okay, that's one way. Think about where you work now. Think about where your family and friends work now. Do you have a partner who works for a business or is a part of a professional organization of small business owners or business owners, or even organizations that could use the service of a VA? Contact your local chamber of commerce. Many of the small firms we were talking about earlier are chamber members. So find that information. Those might be good leads for you. Start Googling and learn about the networking events in your area. Every city on the planet has networking events for businesses, either run through the chamber or through every other organizations. Start to find out when those networking events happen, and then many slides ago, we talked about having your elevator pitch. Have your pitch ready about why, what you do, and why someone should hire you as a virtual assistant. All right, and then you're always going to be mindful of representing your brand. I want to tell you about a time a few years ago where I was at the grocery store. And so, you know, I wasn't in my professional attire. I think maybe I even had a ball cap on that day. But I ran into a fellow I knew from high school. It was just such a random coincidence. And I had heard, I don't know, on Facebook or something, that he owned his own painting company. So he was a painter and he was a small business owner, right? I think he had a couple of employees. But I ran into him. I was like, oh, hey, how's it going? Hey, I heard you own your own painting, you know, your own painting business now. How's that going? And eventually the conversation came to, well, Penny, what do you do? And I took that opportunity. I didn't tell him I was a teacher. I didn't tell him I had worked as an administrative professional. I took that opportunity to say, hey, I own my own virtual assistant business. I could really help you wrangle up the office work that needs to get done if you feel like that could be useful to you, right? So you're always ready with your brand. You're always ready to connect. Now, those in-person opportunities are still live and happening. Don't ignore them. Don't think that they're old-fashioned or out of date. They still happen on a regular basis. But now added to that are all of our online opportunities, so that we're going to be out there networking on LinkedIn, connecting to business owners, connecting to other VAs, connecting to other to networking organizations. Cities across America not only have networking opportunities for businesses, but many have networking opportunities specifically for virtual businesses. APs are not the only ones who can become virtuals, right? My CPA is my accountant is a virtual accountant, right? I never meet with him in person. I submit all of that stuff electronically. Graphic designers are virtual. Lots of people are working as virtual employees. Join that networking group. Virtual businesses really want to help other businesses. And so there's a very nurturing environment that's out there. And then I'll also just encourage you to connect with your other VAs online and in person. I have never come across an experience where another VA wasn't anything but 100% supportive of a new VA to the field. We've been there, we've been through the field, we want to help others succeed, and we know that the work out there, it's not so much a competition, it's just finding that right niche. And so virtual assistants will actually sometimes subcontract to other virtual assistants. So get to know your fellow VAs and encourage those networking opportunities as well. Okay, when you are ready to go live, you're going to have to do certain steps to make sure that your business is going to succeed. First of all, make sure you have the credentials to back up your experience, whatever that may be. So on the screen, I'm just showing you, most people don't know that colleges are accredited. As APs, we're accredited too. So be ready to show the types of certifications and credentials that you have that demonstrate you have the experience that that client can rely upon. Make sure that you do all of your small business planning preparation. So you're going to have a small business plan that defines your audience and identifies your scope. We talked about that scope when we were thinking about what are the goals for our business. Make sure that you understand the kind of management and coordination that's going to be required of the different projects that you're going to take on. Think about the parameters of your work. What will you do and what won't you do? Try to visualize the work ahead of time so that you have those clear parameters. And then I just got done talking to you about all of the networking concepts that you have to outline for yourself. How many hours a day are you going to be on LinkedIn, connecting with other people? How many hours a day are you going to be out networking to attract clients? What social media presence are you going to have that people can then follow up on? All right, next up on our list, when you're ready to go live with your virtual assistant business, you need to master these pieces of knowledge and skill. So make sure that you have your physical workspace set up, and for running your office, make sure you understand the other resources that you have to have in place, such as your technology, right? Webcam, microphone, laptop, tablet, whatever it needs be, do you need to have a Dropbox, a virtual Dropbox, so that clients can submit files to you, not always through email because some are too big or emails get blocked? What kind of email system are you going to use for your own virtual assistant business? All right, so make sure you're ready to manage your virtual office. The email slides into the next category, which is our collaboration tools. How will people find you? Will you be using social media, LinkedIn? Will you have a website? How will clients connect their files and their resources? Google Docs is very popular, but it's not secure in the least. So what are you going to do for your clients' files? And then when you're ready to launch, how will you maintain all of this over time? How many hours a week are you going to dedicate to each of these categories on the screen? All right, so once you're ready to go live, some ways that you can sell yourself are the idea that you're 100% online, but you're also there in person as a human, ready to meet your clients' needs, right? The 100% online is just so attractive. Don't forget to mention it. Sometimes as VAs, we forget it. We take it for granted because it's in our name, right? The virtual part of it. But so you want to be sure to remind people that it's 100% online. They don't have to worry about nurturing you or babying you or training you, right? You're ready to hit the ground running. That you are affordable. We talked about that salary structure. People will need convincing that you are affordable at that rate of pay. And remember, in the end, you're profitable. Number three, this yellow one, this bright yellow one, it's your expertise that you bring to the table. It's your years of experience in the field. It's the skills that you have. It's that expertise that really is what they're paying for. And that's going to make the difference between you and anybody else. And then the last thing is the reliability. This is where APs come in super handy because, right, it's who we are. We're always on time. We're always a little bit early. We're always paying attention to those details. We are reliable to a fault, and that's a selling point for you. So all put together, the advantage that you bring to your VA business is your credentials, your work experience, and that you are a pro, right? You're an administrative professional. You are a pro at this kind of work. All right, can you see how this is sort of, I'm trying to also help you frame it in these tight, concise ways, so that you're getting towards your elevator pitch, right? You're thinking about how can you sell what you do in sort of a concise yet appealing manner. All right, so then the process. We talked about already, you've identified your goal and you've done all that pre-work to set up your business. Once you are ready to go live, you need to connect with others and you need to start spreading your reputation. And so sometimes at the beginning, I'm just going to put this thought in your head. You can follow it or not follow it, but you might want to take on a pro bono work. If you're going to do work for free to get your reputation out there, make sure it's with someone who's going to be grateful for that work and who knows that that work is going to come to an end, that you're not going to be sort of sucked into long-term free work, because that's not the goal of our business. The goal of our business is to be a business, but maybe for a nonprofit agency or for a little project like a Girl Scout troop, maybe you could help organize an event. So start spreading your reputation and then follow up on every lead. Right, when I was in that grocery store with the man I used to know in high school, I could have, you know, I was in my ball cap. I was just picking up groceries for Saturday morning breakfast. I could have been like, you know, it's so great. I'll connect with you later and keep on walking. You need to, if you're going to be a successful virtual assistant, if you want your business to get off the ground, you need to follow up with every lead possible. All right, are you ready? I know, it can be overwhelming. We have covered a lot of ground today. Just don't let it overwhelm you. Don't let it scare you. Really just let it soak in. Launching a business can seem scary, but just start with that one step of planning, right? Just that one thing. Let the information soak in and start your planning. If you have any questions at all, you are welcome to reach out to me at any time. you can follow up with my email address or look me up. I'm on all of it. I'm on LinkedIn and Twitter and the whole deal. Penny Johnson, Madison College. You can do a little search for me and let me know if you have any questions at all. I'm happy to help, right? We're all in this boat together, and I wish you the best of luck in starting your own virtual assistant business.